0141 951 1025. It's time to talk football. It's Clyde One Super Scoreboard.
Good evening and welcome to Clyde One Super Scoreboard as we edge our way into the international break. Rangers' postponed game at Dundee will take place on the 10th of April, 3 days after the meeting with Celtic. Manchester United will play Philippe Clement's side in a pre-season friendly at Murrayfield this summer. And Scotland gets set to head to Amsterdam for Friday's friendly against the Netherlands. I'm Gordon Duncan, and joining me tonight you have Jim Duffy and Kenny Miller. It is not the busiest midweek I've ever seen, but Scottish football will always produce something. We're at a very important part of the season, Kenny, and once Scotland get the friendlies done and dusted, we'll be looking towards the Euros. We've got a title race, plenty still on the go.
Absolutely. You know, again, it becomes quiet over the international breaks, particularly when it's friendlies. I mean, you know, the whole country's been reinvigorated by the national team over the last few years, and you had that wonderful campaign that led to qualification for the Euros, so you were always engrossed in what was upcoming. But when it gets to friendlies, you know, there's still a lot of work to be done for Steve and his players in terms of their prep for the Euros. Again, firstly, they want to get back to winning ways as well after five games without a win. But yeah, like you say, after these two friendlies are out of the way, you've got a real league title race on between Rangers and Celtic. You've got the Euros to look forward to this summer, so it's all to play for in the last couple of months of the season.
As far as our pundit lineup goes, Kenny Miller has the most caps and Jim Duffy is the biggest Scotland fan out of all our pundits. So you're a dream combo for this week.
Yeah, I don't know. I've seen Kenny playing plenty of time for Scotland and, you know, was cheering them on, that's for sure. But I think that it is, I agree with Kenny, the friendlies are difficult because, you know, we've qualified, we're looking forward to the tournament in the summer. But the league campaign is the main aspect of what will be important to the fans in this part of the world. And obviously there's another big derby at the weekend, with the Rangers women playing Partick Thistle women in the cup final on Sunday. So that's always good for the women's football to get a wee bit of a spotlight on their own this Sunday.
Brian Graham, busiest man in Scottish football this weekend, you have to say. Right, 0141 951 1025, what are you thinking tonight? The breaking news today, and you almost wonder if Scottish football is the only place that we get so involved in debates about scheduling and matches being called off and rearranged. But it's what we do here, isn't it? Monday night we spent ages looking over the postponement between Dundee and Rangers. Now we have an update. We know when that game will be played. It will be the 10th of April, which is 3 days after the game against Celtic. Now, part of the discussion on Monday was around, well, when will this take place? Is it going to come before the Celtic game? Is that an extra exertion for Rangers? Does that mean they'll be more tired? Do you have the game after? Then perhaps Rangers can't go into that derby top of the table, the psychology. You know the way we do it here. But now we've had an answer of sorts. So the game will take place on the 10th of April. And I want you to do what you do. Do what we do here. Any of your thoughts, theories, considerations, this is the time and place to share it. 0141 951 1025. And it's not just aimed at you Rangers fans, I suppose. From your perspective, is that a relief? Would you rather not have played it the week leading up to the Celtic game? Or have you got a different take on it for you Celtic fans? Does it matter really? Does it add anything to the psychology heading in to the game? Let us know. 0141 951 1025, because it's one of those topics that you might be fooled into thinking, ach, what do you really say about that? We will say a lot about it in this part of the footballing world.
Yeah, I mean, clubs, if you play for Rangers or any of the bigger clubs, then you must be used to playing games that matter all the time. You have to deal with the pressure, the anticipation, the demands of playing for a club like that. So whether the game had been pre the weekend or post the weekend, then you have to be able to deal with that. But from my side of it, or my opinion of it, Gordon, would be, I think it's an advantage for Rangers to go into this match, to have the Dundee match after the Celtic match. I don't think there's any question about that. They could have had injuries, yeah, you're right, psychologically, if they won, they could go into the game top of the league, but you know, you could be playing a heavy pitch, they could have injuries, the preparation, they have to delay it a little bit. So for me, I think it's a slight advantage for Rangers to play the game after it.
I'm just going to jump in because Jim's just fueled Glasgow now by claiming it's an advantage. I'll tell you what, it would have been an advantage, the game actually been on. You know,
Because Rangers were coming off the back of a heavy night in Europe.
Well, listen, heavy pitch. But they've done that many a time before.
I don't know.
I don't really think it's I wouldn't call it an advantage. I would definitely have picked after. You know, I just think when you look at the games that are scheduled, I would much rather it be...
So it's an advantage.
Out of the options available, it's an advantage.
It's definitely, right. For me, it's definitely the better one. You know, I think Hibs, Dundee, Celtic sounds tough. You know, when you go Celtic, with the greatest respect to Dundee and Ross County, Celtic, Dundee, then Ross County doesn't sound as tough. Considering it's two really tough games, I think either side between Hibs and Celtic, it would have been a tough one. So listen, I'll go with Jim, it's an advantage, but it's I would much rather that game be on and have full week's preparation. So it's still no easy to go a midweek game. Like you say, you're going to have to go to Dundee and go to Dingwall, you know, which is not going to be easy over a 4-day period.
Well, come on then, see, there are arguments to be had quite clearly. So what do you think, Rangers fans? Is it a relief to see it not take place before the Celtic game? Do you not care? You want to spin it some other way? Celtic fans, I suppose you would have a theory as well, because we always have theories on everything. Or maybe you're just feeling really calm and pragmatic about things and you want to phone in and tell us that none of this makes any difference. That's fine. I would happily hear that opinion as well. 0141 951 1025. Maybe you do want to look ahead to Scotland as well. I know it's a bit it's a touch before that sort of pick your team, but there's a lot of considerations to be in there about the friendlies and who can and can't play their way into contention, and we'll hear from some of the Scotland camp as well. So there's a fair bit going on. I don't know if anyone's got thoughts on Rangers against Man United, a friendly at Murrayfield. I guess these sort of glamour fixtures happen. We mentioned Celtic earlier in the week.
Listen, the game is always about you know, trying to spread the globally the games, and whether you're Manchester United, the Rangers, or any teams. We saw that you know, the summer fixtures coming up for Celtic, going to play in a tournament in America against some of the bigger English Premier League clubs and that as well. And that's what we've got to do in Scotland. You know, we've got to expand our game. We've got to expand the profile of the game, you know, to make sure that we can get more revenue in, because the only way that our clubs can improve to the level they want to get is by gaining more revenue. And they can't always do it through income streams of fans coming in, because they're both pretty much guaranteed sellouts anyway. So they have to look at the wider base, Gordon. So for me, from a marketing point of view, I think it's always good that if we can get these type of games.
I do, from time to time, struggle to keep up with your various Rangers spells. Were you there at the Man United game in the Champions League?
Yep.
Memories? Fond?
Oh, what was that? Shift up front at Old Trafford and Waters, and that was an island that night. That was we got a 0-0, so it was all worth it. And then even in the return leg, it was a late Wayne Rooney penalty, if I remember. Right. It was a late one. I don't actually think it was a poor penalty. Had VAR been in, it probably wouldn't have been a penalty that night.
That's so, it, I'm going to open that can of worms. So, which decisions have gone against your team in the years leading up to VAR?
Yeah. In the last 100 years.
But no, it was good. I mean, listen, you're playing Champions League football, you're playing against the best team. So yeah, it was a good fixture to be involved in. And yes, and it'll be a brilliant preparation fixture for Rangers in the summer against one of the best teams in England.
Right, 0141 951 1025. Whatever you want to discuss, get your thoughts in right now. Greg is on the line. How are you, Greg?
I'm okay, Gordon. How are you?
Oh, good. All good in here. What are your thoughts tonight then?
All right, Jim. All right.
Hi, Greg.
My thoughts are that I think Rangers have kind of, the fans have kind of ran away a wee bit with their own mind in that, and thinking that they've won this league. And with us having Hitati back, when he comes back, which is in the next couple of weeks, McGregor and Big Vickers back, I just think we're far too strong for the running for them. That's my point on it.
Well, I'll jump in straight away. I think Hitati's been a huge loss. What level he'll be at when he comes back initially, again, we'll see that pretty quickly. On the Callum McGregor coming back, well, he's been available all season, and the team's toiled at times. Carter Vickers has been in and out through injury. Can he stay fit would be my big thing. I think he's about 50% of the league games that he's been available for this season, which for a big player is not a lot. So listen, if all them come back and they're in the team and they're firing all cylinders, there's no doubt you would expect Celtic's performances to improve. But I think on the Callum McGregor one, he's been there. What has he missed, the last two games or so, whatever it's been? So he's been there, and he's maybe not quite been the influence over the Celtic team this season is what he has in past seasons. But I absolutely agree with Greg. They're top players. Celtic, I've said all along, I've got really good players. They're a really good team with a top manager. And I don't think I would write them off at your peril if you're a Rangers fan. It's not going to be easy. There's a lot of work to be done, and there's a little matter of two Old Firm games to navigate as well, which at this moment in time, Celtic have won the previous two. So it's up to Rangers to show that they can deal with that game.
I mean, I think that I agree with you, Greg. If everyone is fit, you know, and as in Kenny mentioned there, match fit, does take a reasonable amount of games, no matter how all the fitness you do, working with the sports scientists, working with all the, you know, the conditioning people, everything. But match sharpness is totally different. And Carter Vickers has been in and out, as Kenny mentioned, and Hitati's missing. It was similar last year. And I think that has, you know, putting a wee bit more pressure on the shoulders of Callum McGregor, because the other guys, I mean, O'Reilly had a phenomenal kind of first, you know, maybe half of the season, dipped a little bit. You know, no one else has really stepped up to the plate to take Hatate's position for me. You know, Bernardo's been in and out a little bit, you know, but there's no one really cemented that. The other role of Waters come in and done okay. But he's not at the level of Hatate. So I agree with you. If all those guys are 100% up to match sharpness, Celtic will be stronger in the running.
I mean, Greg, we've been discussing this scheduling and whether or not it mattered that Rangers' game against Dundee goes after the meeting with Celtic. From a Celtic perspective, were you hoping it would be before? Did you think that could lead to a tiredness, or did we overthink that stuff?
I think it's irrelevant when they play them.
Yeah.
It's going to be a game, and what'll happen will happen on it. But I just think that they're putting themselves under a bit of pressure. I mean, it was quadruple they were getting shouted, then that's away, so it's treble now. So hopefully, if Vickers comes back, I would play Vickers if he was 65% fit, 60%, definitely, without a doubt. He's on that park. If he's on the park, it's a massive difference to Celtic, because he controls everything. Even his out ball, you know what I mean? He can find passes and all that. He's a class player.
Yeah, and I don't think many would disagree. I wonder, though, without sounding like a physio, because I've not any idea what I'm talking about, but I wonder if, to make sure he's fit long term, you can't play him at 65%. And I get Greg was probably exaggerating a touch, but I wonder if that's been part of the issue, you know, when players come back and they're so important and you want to use them, and then you maybe need to take them off, and then it's another niggle.
Greg's making the point that, you know, his quality is that he could get away with being 65-70% fit. But, you know, if it's a muscle injury, that just can't happen, because you're going to aggravate it. You're not going to put yourself out for longer spells. And that's probably what's happened. They've tried to manage it. They've taken them off. They've used them sparingly. But there comes a time at this stage of the season, you've got to be 100%, because the intensity, the demands, you know, there is no opportunity now to take your foot off the gas. You've got to be absolutely 100% full steam ahead now if you want to win this title. And, you know, Carter Vickers has to be, you know, a vital part of that, but he has to be at his best. I don't think you can play the remaining games at 70%. As good as Carter Vickers is, you know, Celtic will have to find another way if he's not. But they do have this little break, and I absolutely think that'll help them. I think this little kind of breather for the likes of Cameron Carter-Vickers will be vital in terms of getting him up to speed. And there'll be other players as well, where it's Hatate, you know, and you go to the other side of the city with Rangers like Kamar Roof and guys like that. There'll be guys that'll benefit from this little breather. There's no question.
Kenny, I suppose the thing, I don't disagree at all with the notion from Celtic fans that Rio Hatate coming back would be a big boost. I think that, you know, based on his talent, that's a fairly non-controversial statement. All of a sudden, we're deep into March. The season's drawing to a close. He started four league games for Celtic this season. You know, time just goes by so fast. You think, oh, well, you know, have him back soon. Four league games. He's all he's started for Celtic so far this season. So you wonder how easy that is then to come back and be the absolute best version between now and the end of the campaign?
Well, you know what? I think, again, without sticking my neck on that, I don't think he will be. I don't, like Jim says, it takes so many games, I think, to get really up to... It's not to say he can't come back and play well, but to be right at that, the peak and influencing the game that he was influencing it before, or like last season, because like I was going to say before he was injured, he's barely played this season, but like last season and previous times where he's been at the top of his game, he's not going to be at that stage. And it might need to be a case of kind of getting him back in slowly. You know, it might not be right, you go, it's 90 minutes all action straight away. It's just, I just think that's impossible for a player that's had the injuries that he's had this season over the length of time. So there's no doubt it'll be, just to have him on the team sheet, I think Celtic fans would be happy. There's no doubt Brendan Rodgers would be happy, and I'm sure his teammates will as well. But they might need to kind of stagger him into the team, whether that's starting and coming off after an hour. And they need to be disciplined with it, because like you say, Gordon, you're bang on. You don't want to be putting your players at risk.
Thank you very much to Greg. Let's bring in Glenn, who's in Cumbernauld. How are you, Glenn?
I'm fine. How are you? Good evening, panel.
Good. What's your point tonight?
My point is, what is the point in having international breaks when the title race is so good, where players can be injured?
Well, I mean, I get why if you view everything in life through the lens of Celtic or Rangers, Rangers or Celtic, then I get that. But UEFA are not just going to do away with international breaks because we've got a title race on our hands, are they?
No, obviously I get that, but I'm talking about all teams in the SPL that have got players playing that could be injured. It could make differences to who wins the league, who doesn't win the league, so forth and so on. I get that we're in the Euros. I get that we've got to try players out. I get all that, but it could lead to various other things.
Yeah, but again, Glenn, like Celtic and Rangers, it's not just Scotland. You know, Celtic and Rangers, Alistair Johnson will be in Canada, and you'll have various Rangers players off doing... I saw Yilmaz get called up to the Turkey squad, didn't he, and various others.
You've got three massive teams in England fighting for a premiership, a multi-million pound industry, and their players will be going. Glenn, you know, if you're a player, you want to be playing for your national side, you want to be playing at the highest level, you've got the Euros, you've got the Euros coming up. It's just part and parcel of football. You know, the fact that there's a title race going on is fantastic. I don't think, I mean, yeah, of course, listen, we've seen over the years, sadly, a player goes away, gets injured in international duty. It's so frustrating when they come back. But it is, I mean, it can happen. It can happen at training. It can happen any kind of game. When it does happen at international duty, there seems to be more of a finger pointed at, you know, clubs the countries when the players go away. I think Steve Clark's already stated, which is actually quite unusual for Steve to come out and say, in this particular case, when it's friendlies, he's more likely to listen to maybe managers who have maybe requested that they don't play quite as many minutes,
and he'll
give
games or
he'll give that a bit more consideration. So I think he's already he's fully aware himself of the importance that players at the clubs.
Do you know what this tells me, Glenn? I'm doing amateur psychologist here. This just tells me that the title race is getting really, really tense, and people are getting worried about everything.
Well, you heard your last caller there. The guy Fitzroy was talking about Carter Vickers and about his injuries, and then the Celtic team and so forth and so on and everything. It's the same with ourselves, with the Rangers team. It's how can I explain it?
No, I get that, Kenny. That's what I'm saying. Yeah. I get why you can't see, some people can't see past the title race. So international breaks, they need to go. You know, everything is viewed through the context of it. As you know better than any of us, unfortunately, you might get injured on international duty. You just might.
Yeah, you might. But again, it's a... You can't take that away from a football. Like Jim says, it's the pinnacle of your career, is representing your country and walking out with the dark blue Scotland on. It was something. Every time I done it with pride, you know, and to have that taken away from you, listen, again, it's understand the thought, particularly maybe this one, because it's the friendlies and there's nothing at stake, and the team, like the Scotland team's flying high at the moment, they're qualified, they've got the Euros on the horizon, that you're maybe just thinking, you know what, forget these two friendlies, and I'm going to concentrate on the league. I get it, but these are a big part in what this preparation is going to be for the Scotland team moving forward. So they're never going to get scrapped, that's right, because we're talking about scheduling. It's part of the football and schedule.
Gordon, I think we would know the answer, but if you're in a title running and you've got these two friendly matches coming up and you've got the opportunity to say, listen, gaffer, you know, I would like to be left out.
I'm saying no, Jim, and I'll tell you why, because somebody might take your place. It's as simple as that. And then I want to have the number nine on my back going to the Euros. That would be it for me. And if you've got that, listen, I think there would be certain players that maybe do have that luxury, to be honest, in Steve's team. But I'm sure those guys, how they've talked about being away with the international team over the last three or four seasons, they would want to be meeting up with their mates and their teammates and going and having a good couple of games in preparation for a huge summer.
Glenn, listen, we'll take any suggestions on here. I don't think it's going to stick, but thanks for taking the time. That was Glenn in Cumbernauld on 01419511025. If you have suggestions for how you would rip up the football calendar or anything else, we're here for you. It's a good time to call, actually. We'll try and get you on next.
You are the voice of Scottish football. Call 01419511025. Clyde One Super Scoreboard.
Kenny Miller and Jim Duffy are here on 01419511025. Please keep the calls coming in. Whatever it is that's on your mind, we would love to hear it, even if it's as bold as scrapping international breaks, because we have a title race on our hands. One of the staple topics for argument's sake, I noticed a bit of breaking news before the travel that Motherwell are now the latest club, as many have done, to be seeking an explanation from the Scottish FA on a number of refereeing decisions following the match against Aberdeen. We are concerned that the inconsistency of decision making is having a serious impact on fans' enjoyment. If you want to wade in on that, please do. 01419511025. I'm sure these two will have something to say a bit later on. But let's bring in William, because he's been hanging on the line. How are you, William?
I know, bad, Gordon, Jim and Kenny.
Hi, Morgan. What's happening tonight then? Yeah. What have you got for us?
Yeah, I was listening to the debate, especially Celtic fans on before, about injuries, right?
Mm-hmm.
There's no team in the Premiership that's had more injuries than Rangers, but this Celtic fan and every other pundit I've been listening to, other radio stations, internet, website and all that, that Rio Itati is a big saviour. Is this the same Rio Itati that Brendan Rodgers benched for the first 2 months? He was interested and played David Turnbull in front of him. What I mean by this is, right, Rangers have got injuries, right? They've got Cantwell, Sterling, Cortez, Danilo. They've got loads of players to come back who can make a difference. Sima, they're the biggest one, right?
Yep.
He'll make more impact coming back for the two teams. If he's playing in the seventh, Rangers are definitely got a better chance of winning. What I'm saying is, as fans, we can moan about injury, but see what the difference between Clement and Rodgers. He's like bigging up these players coming back, and Clement's just focused on who he's got. He's not cared about injuries. He just wants to play who he's got there. He's not talking about injuries. What's your thoughts?
Listen, I have to agree what you're saying. It's Philippe Clement, he's said that, actually. He's quite... quite open in saying he would rather not discuss who's not available and talk about who is available, you know, because ultimately that's the guys that can help you. Of course you want your injured players to be back quick and soon and have them available, but at that moment when they're injured, when you're doing your pre-match press, you've got to focus on the group that's in front of you, and that's the group that's going to hopefully take you to 3 points. I also do get when you've got an important player coming back, and you're right, Brendan did leave him out at the start of the season because he maybe wasn't quite at the intensity that he wanted, or he wasn't doing the job the way he wanted him to do it, but there's no doubt he's a good player, and Jim touched on it at the start of the show. There's no been anybody really came in and grabbed that shirt alongside Matt O'Reilly and Callum McGregor. You've had Turnbull, you've had Bernardo, you've had Iwata, you've had Thiago Holm. All these guys have played in this position over the course of the season, and I think Hatate at the top of his game, he's better than them all, so that's why they want them back. It's a really important time of the season, as we know, but no, you're right, it's like rather than waiting on a saviour, because we have discussed also it is going to take them at least a few weeks for me to get right back up to speed.
Is there something in that, you know, that, because you can't really argue with the facts, and William rhymes all those players off, they have been missing for Rangers, where Philippe Clement he set his stall out quite early, didn't he, in terms of just not really bemoaning that stuff?
I mean, I think he mentioned that he would maybe look at the training programmes and, you know, the kind of sports science area, you know, early on to kind of get to the point of why they're getting so many injuries. So he obviously, you know, touched on it, but in terms of selection and his focus on the 90 minutes ahead of him, as Kenny said there, he always, I think, put his trust in the players who were available. I think it's good man management to say, listen, I'm not even worried about the guys that are not fit. You know, you're fit enough and you're good enough to go and play and go and get a result. The only thing I would say about, you know, I think it was Greg that mentioned it at the very start, is that there's no doubt Celtic would be better and would be stronger. It's not a case of who's got the most injuries, how do we compare them, you know, in terms of the strength and depth. Both clubs, if there were those players available, would be stronger. Mm. I don't think there's any question about that. Whether it's three or four players for Celtic or whether it's five or six players for Rangers, if you've got all your top players available, it gives you squad strength, it gives you better competition, it gives you a more of an edge. And again, then it's down to who performs on the day on a consistent basis.
So William, you think if there was a hypothetical race to be fit for the seventh, you think out of both sides, Abdallah Sima is the one that would have the biggest say coming back?
Absolutely. What was he on, 14 goals? Mm-hmm. Many goals would he have scored if he stayed injury free? Since he got that injury in Africa, Gordon, you know what I mean? He's definitely got that raw pace, what Ann Kenny stated, and he can score goals, you know what I mean? But Jim's not getting my argument right. Brendan Rodgers is moaning about injuries. He's wanting these players back, come on, snow. So Jim's argument doesn't stack up that way. My point is, come on, it's only where he's got it, and Brendan Rodgers doesn't.
Right. Well, I mean, again, I think if you get, depends on, you know, if a manager, some managers like to just kind of push it to the side, and as I mentioned, Philip Clement concentrating the players got. Other manager maybe answer the question differently. So somebody talks to him about an injured player, they might give a wee bit more of a, you know, detailed injury report. Maybe they think that's the best way to deal with it. But regardless of it, William, it'll come down to who's available on April the 7th and who turns up on the day. No, the ones that are not available, regardless of how the managers portray it before the game, it'll be the starting 11 and the subs that are available, because obviously that can make a turn. And hopefully not influenced by any referee or VAR decisions on the day, which will be a pleasant surprise.
Here's the debate you never knew you needed or never knew existed. Which injured player would have the biggest impact right, if they made it back for the seventh? There you go.
Well, I'll give you one for each side. I think Sima would be, and I think it would be Hitai. I'm not counting Carter Vickers because he's back, yeah, and he's going to be available for selection. But Hitati's been a loss. Again, the Hitati that we've seen would be a loss. If he's back at that level, then absolutely. And Sima, you're right, it's actually 15 goals he's got. And you're right, William, from that left flank, he would have been a 20-plus season, which would have been incredible for that area of the pitch. So he's been a big loss in that. I still think he's very, very raw, and there's still a lot of kind of things he could improve on. But in terms of the impact he made on the team, I think, he's been a huge loss.
So maybe to meet in the middle a bit about William's assessment of the managers, is that maybe why less is said about it? Like, I don't hear... the irony being, we are talking about it now, and some Rangers fans will mention it, but we don't hear much about, when Sima comes back.
I think long-term injuries is different, Gordon, because you can't keep asking someone, you know, week after week, you know, when do you think they're back? They'll only talk about it when he's in and around the squad, when he's in training, when he's maybe had a couple of bounce games or behind closed doors, when he's really close to making a first-team appearance, as... You know, Brendan Rodgers mentioned about Hitati. You know, he's not been mentioned week after week, you know, but now that he's close enough, the biggest one for me would be McGregor, because McGregor's dominated the two Old Firm games. So if McGregor's missing, that would be a massive boost for Rangers in that game.
William, what about this Dundee game? Is that a relief to see it played after the Celtic game? Did you not care either way? What's your take on that news?
It wouldn't have bothered me the way, Gordon. If it would won it, it would be in front. But if we beat Celtic, it'll know you're a mark, because then we've got a chance to just stretch lead when we play Dundee. It's probably better get the two teams will have a full week to get through their training, their prep and all that, and it should be a good game, you know.
Yeah, so Wednesday 10th of April for the, you know, we did allude to it earlier, but to give you some of the facts, 8 PM kickoff, it is going to be in Sky Sports. It was clearly only going to be that week or the week prior, as we said, the week leading up to the Celtic game. I mean, both clubs need to agree to dates and stuff like that. Your gut telling you Rangers, if they would have rather played it after the Celtic game, you think?
I would have. Yeah. You know, and it's not just because it's like, oh, you're a midweek game. Well, it is actually exactly because it's a midweek game. Because I think even if I'd been Brendan Rodgers in that situation, I think he would much rather have had that full week's prep leading into the Old Firm game than having it. Because again, your full focus, and particularly the way Philippe Clement's worked and operated, his full focus is on what's in front of him. So Dundee would have been in front of him on that Wednesday night, and he wouldn't be switching his thoughts to Celtic to the Thursday. Now you've got a full week ahead of you now where you can focus, by the way, you can recover properly after the previous game. You can do your recovery days, you've got then your prep days, and then you've got the big show on the 7th of April. So for me, absolutely, I think Rangers would definitely have been asking it for after.
Here's the other potential issue. I suppose if you aim, as the league and the clubs have done, for the second of those two 3 weeks, and then the rain comes down again.
There's no spare weeks after that.
You know, if it was going to be the week leading up to the Celtic game and it was postponed, you've got the next week to try again. So it's an all or nothing attempt.
It's a whole new level we've went to here.
I think if Dundee, you know that. I think if there's a spit of rain, as they would say in Glasgow, then they want to get some sort of cover over that.
Like 5,000 fans with brollies.
Anything. I think they just do anything and everything to make sure that there's not a drip falls on that dense park pitch between. The weekend and the Wednesday.
Quite interesting though. I mean, it's not often. I actually can't remember last time we had a televised Scottish top flight game up against
Champions League
games. I know there used to be sort of rules, and some leagues just started doing it, and I think it was a small fine. You take that in the chin. I don't remember it happening in Scotland, so it's an interesting one there. Right, let's bring in Craig. What's your take on this rescheduling, Craig?
Well, it's interesting. Obviously, Jim Duffy's sitting with his Celtic hat on, and, you know, and I'm saying that with a smile on my face. But
that's former Dundee manager Jim Duffy you're talking about, Craig. Bear that in mind if you would.
Again, he could be sitting with his Dundee hat on, Gordon. It's Sophie's choice here when it comes to when to reschedule that game. But, you know, obviously being a Rangers fan, I'll look through a Rangers prism. But if you look through it for the other, say the Old Firm game goes ahead, we win, and let's just say one of the bigger players, Tav, Butland, Goldson, one of them get injured. Then you go up to Dundee on the Wednesday night, and you're asking fans to go up to Dundee on the Wednesday night. Then you're asking them to go up to Dingwall on the Sunday. Let's say Dundee draw or beat Rangers, and come the end of the season, which is only that, well, the last round of games will be that Sunday, and they finish above Hibs in the top six by a point. Well, Dundee have technically then playing a weekend Rangers team. So I get that there's no choice, but to say it's an advantage, I think, is a gross exaggeration on Jim's part, because there's no advantage here.
You make a very good case, Craig, to be fair. I wonder if we're getting a wee bit, we're pinning Jim Duffy in that one word. I think what Jim meant.
I actually said slight advantage, which is even. You didn't put that in.
I'll take
away the slight, because it is an advantage. I've got no backtracking whatsoever.
In terms of the two options, Craig, that's what it means. That's what he means in terms of advantage. If you can choose that first week or that second week, it's better, it's advantageous to pick the first one. I think that's all it is, rather than it being some unfair, magical advantage. I think that's more what it is, isn't it? If you had to choose, if you were the decision maker, Craig, which one would you have picked?
As I'm trying to say, there's more than just Rangers at play here.
No, exactly, but just as an example, if you're being honest, if you had the choice.
You 100% you would have said after the Old Firm game.
Well, I think that's
so that's not an advantage then, Craig?
To who?
To Rangers.
To Rangers, because they're not having to play a game before they play Celtic.
Well, but they've still got an extra midweek game, so there's no advantage.
The preparation, the fact that you could get
told you, I just told you to. I told you to about the word advantage.
This is peak Scottish football. I think Craig's hearing that you're somehow sort of angry and that this is such an advantage to Rangers. I think Jim, as Craig has now agreed, is just saying if you had the choice, you would pick that one.
I
really wouldn't worry about it, Craig.
And you know what? It would have been put to Rangers, there's no doubt about it, and Dundee for that matter. And they had to agree, and they both agreed that's the date that they will play the game.
Yeah, one thing I do agree with Craig in the sense that Dundee are vying for a top six position. But again, even from their point of view, they might be thinking, well, you know, if Rangers that gives them a bit of a gap in the week leading up to it, maybe to try and get some players, because I think Tony Docherty, we're talking here about Rangers and Celtic players, the amount of injuries they've got. Tony, but Dundee have got a huge injury list, so maybe that extra few days or an extra week allows him to get some players back available again. So yeah, I mean, Dundee would be going for that as well, so whether that would be an advantage to Dundee or not.
Stop using the word advantage. I'm sick of it. Thank you to Craig, though, who's got us going. Craig and Airdrie, let me tell you about this before we go any further. Clyde won. Right, this is definitely a disadvantage on Make Me a Winner, because the last call went to five rings. That's more than a disadvantage. That is a disaster. But don't worry, there is plenty more cash up for grabs, which means you could be the winner of £178,000 tomorrow when we make another call. But you need to be in the draw. Text YES to 61025. Texts are £2 plus your standard network rate. You can enter at Clyde1.com with online entry costing £2, or call 0330 880 4523. And those calls are charged at a standard rate. It's over 18s only. All the rules for this network competition can be found online. And if you get the call after 3 p.m. tomorrow, answer within five rings, say Make Me a Winner straight away, don't say anything else first, and that's how you win the £178,000. Text YES to 61025.
0141 951 1025. This is Scottish football's league leader, Clyde One Super Scoreboard.
Jim Duffy and Kenny Miller are here on 0141 951 1025. They're joined in spirit by Hugh Keevans, whose message to say he's getting dizzy listening to all the calls, and he has the advantage of sitting in his kitchen, he says. We have had some quite
get a kettle on
pedantic Hugh debates already tonight, but there we go. Let's bring in Craig in just a second. I'm going to bring you up to speed on something that I think Craig has on his mind. So it's something I alluded to earlier. Motherwell have issued a statement tonight saying they've written and submitted a video package to the Scottish FA seeking an explanation on rules regarding handballs. This is after the Aberdeen game at the weekend. There is a more general point in there about VAR as well. So, Craig, that's got your attention, I believe.
It has indeed, guys, and good evening to you.
Hello.
Hi, Craig.
So, yeah, so Motherwell aren't a complaining club historically, and I think now just enough's enough. We need to get rid of its video assistant referee, and it's there to assist the referees. But with the quality of referee we have in Scotland, we're still getting the contentious decisions. So yeah, if there was something that was brought in, which we were all sold that VAR would be, that would confirm if something was offside, would confirm if something was a handball, would confirm if something was dangerous play, then all good and well. But it's still being left up to people's interpretations. The handball rule, you know, just keeps changing. Now they're talking about the offside rule changing. So our referees are really at the standard where they should be dealing with all these rule changes. When you're at the game, though, to me, VAR, though, if you're watching Monday Night Football on Sky and you've got your experts there who are dissecting it as they're showing it frame by frame, but you know, I'm a season ticket holder, I go to the games. When you're sitting there for 5 minutes, oblivious to know exactly what's happening, you don't see it, it's wasting time, the crowd get restless, and then half the time it's the wrong decision anyway. Clubs are spending a lot of money on it, money that they could be spending on, you know, squads. We're still at the business end at the bottom of the table. Looks like Livingston probably will go down, saving a miracle, but Ross County have pulled it out of the bag. I think for the playoff place, there's still four or five teams in that mix, and I think we just need to get back to referees making their own decisions. Sometimes they will get it wrong, but they're getting it wrong with VAR anyway.
Yeah, and I think Craig and Motherwell's statement hit on two separate points. Firstly, it's, you know, the handball rule, the implementation of that, how hard done by Motherwell feel. And by the way, they're not the only team. No. There's so many, obviously. And then that separate point about the existence of VAR and what it's sort of doing. I don't know, take them in whatever order you want. Let's go specific. Let's go to the reason that Motherwell have issued a statement about it tonight.
Well, I agree with Craig to an extent in terms of, I was actually at the Motherwell Aberdeen game at the weekend and never had a clue what was going on.
Gordon Dale give you a season ticket?
He did not, absolutely not. It was a thing, I think I seen the empty seat in the stand. But yep. Anyway, it was never had a clue what was going on. I genuinely thought it must have been, as Lennon Muller's shot, because it took about two or three ricochets on the way through, it must have been hit someone's, hit a Motherwell's player hand on the way and it's went in.
And then when the goal was chopped off, I thought, yeah, that must have been it. And then it wasn't until after you thought it was the ball brushed past Theo Bear's arm on the way out to Lenny Miller, which I feel they've been hard done by in that. You know, and I've listened to the show over the weekend, I've listened to other opinions on it. It's my opinion that that's not a handball. And I felt they were really, really tough done by. So clearly, this has been the straw that's broke the camel's back in terms of Motherwell. They've felt they've had to, they've been on the receiving end of a number of poor calls, and they're now seeking to see, right, OK, where are we going with this? Because I think this is a question we've talked about on this show probably every single week for the season in relation to the handball rule. Again, I just think it is the rule. You know, I think it's and it's always going to be open to interpretation. I would love to know, again, Philippe Clement talks a lot about it, make it clearer, make it more simpler for the referees. I would love to know how that's going to be done, because mm-hmm. for me, you're still going to have these situations where the ball hits a hand or it doesn't hit a hand, and you're going to, or when it does, you're looking at a referee, looking at a monitor, if he's called to it, or you're looking at a VAR referee, mm-hmm. and it's their interpretation of that particular situation. And I just don't think how you can ever get everybody agreeing on it, and I don't think you ever will.
This is the week, of course, that it was announced Crawford Allen will no longer be the Scottish FA's head of refereeing operations. You wonder if, can there be a real... Because to a point we're left in the dark, I'm quite lucky, and I'm referencing it on the show, quite often get along to briefings and so on, but even that, I'm now seeing stuff that doesn't quite match what I took away from some of those. So what guidance is being given to the referees? What is it that they are specifically told about handballs? Okay. It would be nice to know that.
Well, Gordon, I've got three, you know, this is from the referees' information here, right? So three considerations. Handball rule, obviously, whether it is a deliberate action by the player,
rubbish.
The proximity of the player from the ball and the speed it hits them on the arm of the hand, and finally, if the hand of the arm is in an unnatural position.
Yep.
Now, if you take those three things and then just think, okay, we'll follow that process for the Motherwell aspect, presuming the only one they can look at is the hands in an unnatural position. And again, as Kenny mentioned there, it's all subjective. Someone on the field thinks that is a natural position. Someone in VAR doesn't. So no matter how we go about this, it's always going to be subjective to whether one person thinks that is unnatural, or the pace, or the follows the rules of handball. But until such times as they are simplified, then we will have this debate continually after every series of games, because, you know, listen, we'll hear people saying, oh, if you're a player, you'll never do that.
Sure.
You've got to take away the player's aspect. This is the rule. These are the rules that are there, and it's the rules that are making it so difficult.
I don't disagree, but I still think surely within that, I think within that you can still be better by really clear, consistent message. As an example, right, because I feel like it becomes easy. Every time now when this happens, lots of people say, I don't even know the handball rule anymore, and what you know, what you're supposed to do. But forget all that, because you've read the rule. The rule is there.
Yeah.
Can you be sure that ball hits Theo Bear on the arm below his T-shirt line? Can you be sure? Yeah. Have you seen it?
Yeah, I've seen it.
And can you definitely tell what it does? Because
no,
I can't.
But obviously, whoever was looking at it said they did. They've obviously went, that hits him in the arm. So
but
they have decided that is, whether you think it is or I think it is, or Kenny, is it material?
I would go a step further. I understand a lot of it's open to interpretation, but there becomes a point where you have to almost acknowledge that from the angles we had
available. What you're saying is what you're saying.
Yeah, that's what I mean. I don't think there's that much interpretation there. I think it was just genuinely very hard to tell where that hit him in the arm.
It was. It absolutely was. And this is the thing where I've seen handballs and when they do that still. See, for me on a still, that's still no conclusive evidence that that's hitting the player's hand. It might look like it is, unless you can see the ball striking the arm or the hand up to the T-shirt line, and then the ball going off in a different direction.
And is that a clear
direction
and obvious error by the referee?
Well, you know what? You've just read the rules.
Motherwell have had a pop at that clear and obvious error threshold. I think that is a bit different, though, when it's in the lead-up to a goal, because ultimately they're just asked to assess if there was anything that should, you know, have the goal ruled out. Very quickly, Craig, because we're a bit pushed for time. Are you glad Motherwell have done this, or is this just one of those things where various clubs do it, doesn't really get anywhere?
I I'm glad that we've done it, because, you know, when a Clyde Motherwell are doing that, then it shows that there's an issue there. As you say, we've had a lot of decisions go against us before and after that. But as I know, I'm glad that they're doing it, because I think they do need to look at it. And I hope the other teams follow suit. And I don't just mean the big two, I mean the other clubs, because I really just think there's no place for it just now. We've got the standard of refereeing that we have.
Yeah, I would just personally like to try and have it as constructive as possible, though, because I'm not saying Motherwell are wrong to do it. I was as annoyed as Andy Halliday and I were messaging furiously on Saturday night, but, you know, team gets decision against them and then that week complains about VAR. Week another team gets a decision against them and that week complains about VAR. It doesn't feel like it's the most constructive way to do it. It doesn't mean that they're wrong to do it, but it feels like it's going to take something bigger than that. Do you know what I mean?
But you're right, Gordon, at the start of the season, when you're saying you go to some of the meetings, all the managers are invited, or the coaches are invited to the rule changes, or the, you know, if there's any tweaking the rules, or they'll show them, and they are referees, and they'll show them these are the aspects of what would be considered handball, and then you get into the season and those situations seem to be a little bit more flexible, should we say.
Thank you very much to Craig, but it's that time of the night already. Beat the Pundit with the Scottish Sun. For the best football news and opinion online, thescottishsun.co.uk/football. It's that type of night, I think we need a bit of comic relief, a bit of light-hearted entertainment, and it comes in the form of Beat the Pundit. You can take on Jim Duffy or Kenny Miller, dent their ego, steal their pride, and win a signed ball as well. So you have to call before 7 o'clock. I've not left you long. 0141 951 1025. Tackle the headlines. 0141 951 1025. Clyde One Super Scoreboard. Jim Duffy and Kenny Miller are here. It's 0141 951 1025. It's one of those interesting midweek shows on international break where, like, you think it's going to be quiet, but everybody's just arguing about everything. Like, we're really holding each other to account by the looks of it tonight. So if you want to discuss the rescheduling of Dundee Rangers, if you want to discuss everyone's favourite topic, which is VAR, that's just came up before the news there on the back of a Motherwell statement following the game against Aberdeen, or anything else at all that's out there, maybe you do want to turn your attention to the international games this weekend, we are here for you. 0141 951 1025. But let's play this first. Beat the Pundit with the Scottish Sun. For the best football news and opinion online, thescottishsun.co.uk/football. Okay, it is Beat the Pundit time. Either Kenny or Jim will be up against Chris in Holytown. How's it going, Chris?
How are we doing, Gordon?
Not bad. Have you ever played before?
Nah, I've never played before.
Do you do okay playing along at home?
I usually play in the car, but like 3 or 4 usually, when there's no pressure on, but we'll see. As long as I get one, I'm good, man.
As long as you guess, we set the bar really low. I don't mind that at all.
Kenny and Jim are sharp, man.
Kenny's got 100% record. He doesn't like it when I keep mentioning it every week to put the pressure on. But
is Andy got 100 or no?
I was listening on Monday to that.
Yeah, he
does.
There
was a VAR intervention, apparently.
I think Andy's got it as well, and Kenny's got it. Won't he have a fight at the end of the season with they two and Roger Hanna?
And Roger, yeah, but although Chris Boyd came on and stitched him up, we still don't know the circumstances really surrounding that one. But anyway, okay, let's toss the coin. If it's heads, it will be Kenny Miller. If it's tails, it will be Jim Duffy. And it is tails. It's Jim up against Chris in Holytown. So we give Jim some greatest hits radio to listen to, just so that he can't hear us. And it's pretty straightforward, Chris. 30 seconds, answer as many as you can. If you want to just pass and move on, that's absolutely fine, okay? Right, 30 seconds starting now. Ryan Porteous currently plays for which English team?
Sheffield.
How many goalies have been included in the Scotland squad for the upcoming friendlies?
4.
Who do Partick Thistle women face in the Sky Sports Cup final on Sunday?
Rangers.
In what year did Motherwell last win the Scottish Cup?
93.
Which current Scotland international has played for Hull, Chesterfield and Leeds?
Pass.
Who was the Celtic captain immediately before Callum McGregor?
Scott Brown.
Okay, let's bring in Jim Duffy. Can you hear us, Jim?
Yep.
Good, same set of questions. 30 seconds on the clock and your time starts now. Ryan Porteous plays for which English team?
Watford.
How many goalies have been included in the Scotland squad for the Four. Upcoming friendlies? Who do Partick Thistle's women face in the Sky Sports Rangers. Cup final on Sunday? In what year did Motherwell last win the Scottish Cup?
1991.
Which current Scotland international has played for Hull, Chesterfield and Leeds?
Pass.
Who was the Celtic captain immediately before Callum McGregor?
Scott Brown.
And which team is bottom of the Scottish Championship?
Arbroath.
Okay. Chris, have you done enough?
They maybe have got one. Mm.
But do you feel like you got the one that you set out for though?
Aye, definitely.
Well, that's fine then. That's everybody's happy.
You've met your targets. That's amazing.
Ryan Porteous plays for Watford. 1-0. James Duffy. Four goalies though. You did get up and running, Chris. I was nervous for you. I always like it when they get the first one.
Yeah.
And you're up and running. Same. So, Gunn, Gordon, Clark, and Kelly. So 2-1 to Jim. You were on a mini run at this point, Chris. You knew as well. Partick Thistle women against Rangers women Sky Sports Cup final on Sunday. 1:30 kickoff at Tynecastle. Incidentally. But Jim got it as well, so stays in front. Honestly, a man from Holytown, just down the road, 1991, it was Motherwell. I'm about to have a mad
what did he say?
Coughing fit if you want to just keep talking.
Keep going, right. You can get a drink of water there. Oh, well. What did you say, Chris? What year?
93.
Well, 93. Well, there you are. Well, let Gordon have a wee drink. He did say he'd have a wee bit of a tickly
didn't
cough.
Didn't I say before we came on earlier it was going to happen at some point?
It's no good if you're the presenter.
I'm having a rough couple of weeks. I'm feeling run down. Anyway, 1991, Chris. So anyway, Jim gets that. Stretches his lead. None of you knew Hull, Chesterfield and Leeds?
Only one I'd say, Liam Cooper.
Yeah, it's just Cooper, Liam Cooper. Celtic captain before McGregor was Brown. Both got it. And I'm afraid Jim got one more and got it right. Arbroath. So 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. 3-1 for Jim Duffy. A defeat.
Liam Cooper's got to be raging at me because I didn't know.
Did he actually?
That's bad when you know the player and you still didn't get that one.
Honestly, how do you know Liam Cooper?
My friend used to drive for him, and he gave us some tickets for the Scotland game. So I met him a few times just at the national games and that.
There you go. Well, yeah, you'll be.
You're not getting your tickets now,
yeah,
Chris.
That's it.
That tickets will be binned.
Exactly. Before we go, producer says you've something else you wanted to share with us, Chris. I'm intrigued to hear what it is.
I've got a big fight coming up in a couple of weeks in the Brayhead Arena. I'm a mixed martial artist. I fight for Cage Warriors. So, Cage Warriors 171, it's in the Brayhead Arena, 20th of April, so it's a massive event for Scottish MMA.
I've put
what,
it together.
What weight are you, Chris? What weight do you fight
I fight a lightweight, Jim.
Lightweight.
A bit lighter than you.
Don't aye, definitely. I'll take that back. An MMA fighter's getting his tickets off Liam Cooper every day of the week.
Chris,
listen, good luck to you, Chris.
I've put it together now.
A tough sport.
I've put it together. Chris Bungard, yet?
Aye, aye, of course.
Good on you, Holytown. I should have put it together. Right. I'm glad, right, but be honest, Chris. Of all the Clyde One Super Scoreboard pundits, Jim Duffy would be the best cage fighter, wouldn't he?
Oh, aye. He beats me to be the pundit and he thinks he can ask me my fight weight, not me.
I know, exactly.
No, I'm just asking, just wanting to know what weight things are, but just in terms of, listen, it's just such a tough sport and I've got, you know, I can't, any combat sport's just incredibly tough. So
but you
listen,
would
I
be the
best
of the Super Scoreboard team, I reckon. I can see
Jim, I seen you in action back in the day, remember?
Maybe a bit.
Was he lively, was he?
Well, maybe about 40 years ago, maybe. But no.
A good story when you might remember the Hibs training when Big Veg and Gordon Hunter came in together and they had a flying tackle, never really got
so
on.
So who are these two?
And Sean Dennis and Gordon Hunter. Sean, and they came, we're doing the old numbers game, one team at one end and you shout on the number and it was, for some reason, they two ended up the same number and they came in and
they were never going back it.
No, it was head height. Mm-hmm. Drop kicks in and the gaffer at the time is like, if any of you want to be fighting, I'll fight yous right now.
Oh, I love fight. That from you, Jim Duffy. I can just see that.
As I said to you, it was a long, long time ago. Believe me, I'm never more of a pacifist.
I'm sure. So Chris, remind us then that the date, the venue, if people can people still head along if they get the chance?
There's a few tickets left and now it's April 20th, Brayhead Arena in Glasgow. Full Scottish card. It's a massive night for Scottish MMA. They've not been here in like 11 years, so it's a huge night for Scottish MMA, a huge night for myself, and my teammates are also on the card with me, so it should be electric. Atmosphere should be electric. It's not nearly sold out, so
want me to try and get Hugh Keevens in your corner for a bit of extra intimidation? to walk out with to the Super Scoreboard theme tune. Imagine that.
Hugh might be a lightweight. He could maybe fight Chris.
No. You've not seen the size of Chris. I don't know what this lightweight business is all about. But anyway, right, Chris, brilliant. All the best.
Good luck, Chris. Right,
cheers, guys.
Cheers, Chris. Good luck.
There we go. Could have delved in. Chris is a big laddie, so it must be one of these shred a bit of weight.
I mean, he'll be ripped, but that's the thing.
Imagine Hugh with the towel round the neck.
In the bucket and all that.
You know, the wee guy in Rocky. What's his name again?
Mickey. I thought you were going to say the wee guy and what was the...
Shuggy.
The Netflix thing that Shug was getting. Linked to all the...
Oh, Squid Games.
Squid Games, yeah.
Like the wee guy with the tracks on. Set on 001.
Yeah.
Anyway, there we go. It must be the first mixed martial artist we've had on Beat the Pundit.
As I say, anybody does that, you get huge respect from the party. To be honest with you, you do not want to be doing that. It is almost licensed thuggery at times. It is unbelievable.
Good on them. Right, okay. 01419511025. That is the number you need. Whatever you want, you can give us a call and let us know what is on your mind. We are building up as well to the international break. I was kind of thinking back to one of the first callers we had talking about friendlies, and I don't want the international break, it's getting in the way, but how good is it to have a friendly and it's not allowed to have that word meaningless before it. Remember people used to always say that, these meaningless friendlies, these are important friendlies.
I would ask, you know, if anybody is out there, we would have a wee chat about it as well, to see whether anybody thinks somebody should be in. Invariably when squads are mentioned, Gordon, there's always debate about who should be in, who should be out, but this particular time there doesn't seem to be anybody omitted that, you know, people are clamouring for. I would have, you know, was just wondering, is there one or two rough diamonds out there that might have had a wee opportunity? Listen, not to go to the Euros, we know that. I think Stevie Clark's too loyal, and I think his squad is pretty much set in his mind. But for these particular games, could there have been an opportunity to blood a couple of boys or deserved of an international call-up? Is there anyone you think? Is there anyone you think, Kenny? I can't think of anyone off the top of my head, but I don't know if any of the listeners can think.
I can't at this moment in time, no. I think the squad, again, it's a bit bigger than what it normally would be as well. Obviously, there's been a pull-up. There's a few guys, obviously, that are nailed on to be going to the Euros if they're fit, in terms of Callum McGregor on it, Aaron Hickey on it. So even at that squad, there's probably going to be three or four guys that are going to be left out of it going to Germany. So listen, I'm with you. I think Steve will have his at least 21 out of the 23 in his head clear, and there might be a few discussions between now and June about who goes.
01419511025. Talk about whatever you like within reason. So let's go to Trevor, who's in Paisley. How are you, Trevor?
I'm good. How are you, Gordon?
Not bad. What's on your mind?
That's good. Listen, I like Kenny Miller, but I feel as though I need to pull him up a bit. That's the fact that he's saying that when we lost five goals in the second half, it was unforgivable against Kilmarnock. I mean, this is St Mirren here, you know. We're no Juventus or anything like that, you know.
Trevor. It just wasn't the second half. It was 18 minutes. Five goals in 18 minutes is unforgivable.
Believe me, Trevor. See, if Jim Duffy was in the dressing room at the time, he'd have been calling it worse than unforgivable, I suspect.
But you know what? I mean, I've seen St Mirren over the years. We've been 3-0 up against them. Barton lost three goals in the last 13 minutes. I mean, these things happen. Do you know what? I don't let it get to me. You know what I mean? St Mirren are well punching this year. I mean, the same as last year. I thought this year we'd have really struggled because I thought last year was just a one-off, you know, but the whole bigger picture, they've just been absolutely outstanding, to be honest, you know what I mean? There's no way enough I could even slag them. I mean, I even seen Chick Young try that after we missed a penalty against Motherwell, and we drew nothing each, and he was trying the same thing, and then obviously Robinson said to him, no, these boys have been great all year, you know, you can't say anything bad about them, you know what I mean?
Basically, so, Trevor has forgiven them. And you're unwilling to.
I absolutely agree with Trevor. Stephen Robinson's done an incredible job. The season they had last year, I agree as well. I thought they might have struggled to kind of match it. Well, they've probably surpassed it this year. They've been in the top six for the majority of the season. But again, I'm not talking about how they've done over the course of the season. They've been outstanding. They've got a really good way of playing. They're clear. The players know exactly their jobs. But by the way, tell Stephen Robinson it's okay to lose five goals in 18 minutes, and I guarantee you he'll not be a happy wee man.
No, very true. But going on to what you just said there as well, Kenny, do you know what I think as well? The reason that we have did so well this year, believe it or not, is because of VAR. And last year, we've had so many winning points with VAR decisions. I wish I was a stato and I could drain them all off. I mean, you just need to go to the Aberdeen game, we get a penalty, then we go on to win the game. Against Dundee, we get another VAR decision where normally if we before bar, we'd have got all these goals never given. We'd have been given offside, we'd have been given no penalties. So I really think the difference between us being in the top six and not being in the top six the last 2 years has been bar has really contributed to that.
I love this call just purely because we just don't hear it, you know, and it's always like my team's
VAR positivity.
My team's hard done by VAR. And eventually we found someone who's, do you know what I think my team has,
I think it's the only caller I've ever heard coming up and, you know, being an advocate for VAR and, you know, real, as you say, real positivity about it. Well done, Trevor.
But see, on a more serious note, is there something in that mindset that we have to, you know, on any given weekend, and it's not just the Monday night, we're now on Wednesday still pouring over them, you do remember the negative ones, you do remember the perceived mistakes, you do shout the loudest about those. And I wonder if that has skewed things a bit, i.e. if you were to take it out completely and then go back to all of these decisions that Trevor's and other mention, would we then say, ah, we've now made a mistake again? Because we should be looking at that again if we've got the chance.
Mentioned an opportunity that went down the go his way about 20 years ago, so... Yeah, VAR, it's always going to be contentious. There's going to be debate about it. But I do think you're right, Gordon, in some aspects. I think, you know, balance is it's probably loaded to more the negative side, I think, quite considerably. When there are positive VAR decisions, it's almost as well, that's what it's there for. You know, and everybody just kind of bats it along. But when it does go, or when we think it's wrong, or when fans think that it's went against their team, that's when, the voices are definitely louder.
I take offside's a good example, Kenny. How many are just marginal and it's just done and you... Yep. I was going to say it's done and you move on. I know you don't, and I know there can be a bit of delay, and that's then a separate argument, but... sometimes you then watch, you know, we watched, was it Partick Thistle in the Championship a couple of weeks ago, and everyone celebrates it and goes, this is football at its best, there'll be no VAR tonight, and then you see a goal that blatantly should be given, and you think, I don't really like that either.
Well, that's, but again, offside's black and white, you know, so it is what it is, and it's been there to correct these. Again, get goals given for what should be goals, and chop goals off that shouldn't be given. So again, there's no advantage gained in that respect. I must say, I've been a wee bit kind of, I think the lines have looked a bit dodgy of late, but that's a new discussion. But just one more thing for Trevor. Is it only VAR that deserves the credit for that, or is it maybe Stephen Robinson and his players a wee bit, Trevor?
Not at all. It's a wee bit of a dig, actually, probably to the refs as well, because before we would never get the decision, do you know what I mean? And that just shows you the amount of penalties we've had as well. It's absolutely made all the difference, I think. But, I mean, because we're not that far into the top six, but we're in it. But I honestly believe that if it wasn't for the VAR decisions, there's no way enough we'd be in that top six.
I mean, I've never heard it before, and that's why I like it.
I'm just wanting to know what's Trevor going to do when Stevie Robinson goes to Aberdeen.
Oh God, don't say that.
Kenny, as a striker, what did you make of, have you seen the one, the IFAB trial about the new offside rule?
I have not, but by the way, fill me in though.
We've not got enough. I'm on intrigued. Our hands. Well, there you are, I'll show you a nice wee graphic, right? This doesn't really work on radio. So basically, it's doing nothing other than just move the point of debate. So you now would need actual daylight between the last part of the attacker and the first part of the striker, if you like.
That's carnage.
So it actually doesn't fix debates really at all. No. But it would just probably lead to
clear.
More goals.
You know, it's clear because of daylight. I think that term's been used a lot in terms of that should be the rule.
Yeah, but
see that other one that's onside, there's a heavy advantage getting on that, you know. So I think that
good though, more goals then.
Well, absolutely. It means, again,
still drawing the dotted lines for the shoulders and stuff.
Well, that's it. You'd still be having that debate.
If there's a body part crossing, you're onside. It's as simple as that. Yeah. So there would be so many more goals because you see that type of picture all the time, and it's a clear offside. Mm-hmm. Now it wouldn't be, so there would be so many more goals. So again, it's maybe more in the entertainment factor for the fans. But I'm telling you, if that goes against you, you're going to be fuming.
Thanks to Trevor, 0141 951 1025. If you want to get involved in the fun and games, you can do, and we would welcome it. So let's hear from you.
Taking your calls on Scottish football, 0141 951 1025. This is Clyde One Super Scoreboard.
Kenny Miller and Jim Duffy are here on 0141 951 1025. Still plenty of time for you to join in. If you want to switch focus, turn attention to the Scotland games at the weekend, we would love for that to be the case as well. So let's hear from you right now whilst I set up this question.
The full-time teaser with Universal Interiors East Kilbride, offering champion bespoke media units to put you right in the game.
Okay, I like the style of David and the Gorbals because it is topical and it's doable, but it's difficult. That has ticked three important boxes for us here on the full-time teaser. So, ahead of the game against the Netherlands, Scotland this weekend, can you name the last seven Dutch players who've made over 10 appearances in the Scottish Premiership? So can you name the last seven Dutch players who've made over 10 appearances in the Scottish Premiership?
Van Veen.
Kevin Van Veen, currently at Kilmarnock, made most of those appearances for Motherwell.
Going back a bit, Quinterman.
We're not going back as far.
Not as far, okay. So Arthur Newman and that before, after
nope,
that.
Nope, after those.
Right, so you've got Kevin Van Veen.
Yeah. Quite tricky, actually.
Is it Van de Veen or Van Veen?
Van Veen.
Van Veen.
Right.
Van Dijk.
Not even going back as far as him. So that's what makes it really tough. I'm looking at the rest of the names and thinking, ooh, you get a couple, but...
The boy... Beasley or something that plays for Aberdeen.
Oh, I mean, you're miles off.
Duke.
No,
it's not Beasley or something.
Okay, Bezigen, yep.
Between the two of you,
yeah. Bezuigen.
Bezawen, is that?
Bezawen, that's it.
Bezawen. Bezawen. Yeah, he's there. Okay, yep. Any more for any more just now?
Bezuigen.
I like how we were struggling with the pronunciation, so you thought it was Duke. You know, Jim can get his lips round that one. No?
Yeah, I couldn't say it.
Sunday name. I wanted to call me Sunday name.
Right. Anyway, we'll leave it there. That's two down, five to get. Thanks again to David. Look, if you like the sound of that, that's the full time teaser. If anyone's never heard it before, and the challenge is that you send the questions in, so you come up with a question, bit of trivia, and we try and get the pundits to answer in roughly the last half hour or so of the show. Thanks as always to Universal Interiors East Kilbride for helping us out as well. William is on the line. How are you, William?
Going well, Gordon, yourself?
Not bad. What made you call tonight?
Well, just say hello to Kenny.
Hi, William.
All right, Kenny. One of my favourite players of all time until you put on the green and grey, but then you come back and made up for it, so we'll not blame you too much for that. But all joking aside, boys, the Samaritan font really triggered me to call there.
Because he praised VAR. Are we not allowed to do that?
Absolutely. I'll tell you why. All you want as a football fan is consistency in the game. And I think one of the problems is that the referees in Scotland are not full-time. I know you can always say the mistakes in England and whatever it may be, but I think there's more mistakes happening in Scotland than what there is in England. But my main point is, why not have the same people watching VAR every week, every game? Because that would bring consistency. Because it's all about opinions, as we all know. Football's all about opinions. Where if you have the same, maybe two or three ex-refs or referees, whatever it may be, and their job is only to do VAR, you're going to get more consistency in the decisions. Because see, at the end of the day, once a referee's pulled over to that screen, 9 times out of 10, he's going to change his mind because there's pressure putting on him by people saying, we think we're wrong here, or have another look at this. Well, what about if the same people was watching VAR at every game, and then the consistency will come with that, and then you'll not see this. There's that handball. Why is that not a handball? No, because it's all about interpretation. It's the same in England. Same throughout the world. Why not have the same people watching the games every week? And their job is to look after VAR and let the people referee the games and whatever it may be. That's the only way you're going to get consistency, in my opinion.
We obviously have a couple of specialised VARs in Andrew Dallas and Greg Aitken, so they only VAR, they don't ref anymore. I'm not 100% sure on this, right? My guess would be, it's probably discouraged that, because ultimately, would you not at least want some of your VARs to then have relevant experience of currently refing and kind of keep your eye in on both sides? Would that not be beneficial, no?
I don't know. I actually quite like the suggestion, because I think once
if you're looking for consistency, you would like to think if it is the same people that are watching, they're going to have the same type of opinion on or interpretation on certain things. But I still I don't think it would lead to the correct decision, because it could still be the wrong interpretation. It could still, I'm sure we would be sitting here every week still arguing about certain decisions that, that VAR have gave or not gave.
But also, so explain it further to me, William. Say you've got six VARs, right, who are dedicated VARs, and they're in there every week. But you're still going to have, that's still six different minds, six different sets of eyes. If they see things differently on week one, they'll still see things differently in week two and week three and week four. What, how will that lead us to a better place?
Gordon, I think you need to cut it down to three. You know, why six people?
No, for
that's
each game.
Six different opinions.
No, I mean for each game. For one for each game.
I'm sorry. Yeah, but what's wrong? You know, you're throwing a spanner in the works, sir. Right,
it's more than a spanner, William. If we've got six games, you need six VARs. There's 12 teams in the league, so you would have six.
Hold on, VAR takes that long as it is anyway. Even when there's only one live game on the TV, for example, it takes that long to make a decision. And with all the camera angles that we've got these days, why not take an extra 30 seconds? Because at the end of the day, it's all about getting the decisions right. It's either scrap VAR or look for a way to improve it. And I think the only way to improve it is if you have the same minds looking at every game. You know, so if there are six games on a Saturday, for example, those three people will mull over those three six games.
Oh, William, hold on a minute. We're saying we're getting decisions wrong and we now want to half the number of people looking at it. And by the way, we also complain that it's taking too long. But William throws in the argument of
the same six, but aye, three watching could, nah. Listen, there's very rarely six games on, but five games definitely. Yeah. to keep your eye over the five, it would be a tough
listen, you need, you'll me, need not, at least just double that amount of people as well, because obviously you can a variety of reasons that someone's not available, but I agree. In principle, if you had one for every game, yeah. I think a VAR expert, as you mentioned,
Andrew Dallas
and Greg Aitken are doing that anyway. So we're already down that route a little bit, William. And I think that will increase as because, I mean, we're still in it. VAR in its infancy in this country, really. So I think over the next year or two, you'll find that more and more people will, I mean, you'll have referees like to Willie Collins or these kind of guys who will eventually just move out of refereeing. Yeah. They'll probably get into the VAR room. More and more experts on VAR, and we'll get better at it, Gordon. There's no question about
it. I think that is an important distinction, because there are, you know, IFAB, FIFA rules in place. Say a retired referee, because I've heard that before, why don't we get more, you know, retired referees? They have to have retired within the last, I can't remember, but say it's 18 months, right? Say it's 2 years, and we actually don't really have any, or we didn't, sorry, when we rolled out VAR. So now Andrew Dallas and Greg Aitken can do it. There might have been one or two. Bobby Madden doesn't currently work for the Scottish FA, but he retired recently. It's not like we've got loads of ex-refs that fall into that.
Bobby Radden, Steve Conway, you get the guys that have retired.
See, when they go beyond that window, are they not allowed to do VAR anymore? So they only have that.
I don't know if it's at the start or whether you can,
continue.
Whether
now you're in it, you're in it.
Maintain that train or whatever. Yeah. But I know you're not. It needs to be retired within a certain time. I say this quite often for no reason other than to maybe just depressingly dampen our expectations, because I take what you're saying, Jim, about, you know, maybe we can get better and hopefully we can. And William mentions that old one that keeps coming back about full-time refs, and and I love your optimism and I love William's optimism. And then I watch Match of the Day and I see 5.5 minutes check for West Ham at the weekend, and I think, okay, they've got everything that we are apparently striving to get to, and it's not any better.
No, see, full-time refs for me, that's not the solution. I just don't understand how being full-time is going to change how you see a certain situation. I just don't think it is.
I get the logic of it, because, like, in life, if you do something professionally, you'll be better at it. But as you say, I take it the ref that penalised John Souter's handball was full time.
Think you mentioned earlier on that we do focus on those events, if you want to call that, in VAR, the kind of real negative ones. I mean, we really make an issue. I think that exactly what you're saying, if you have people there and that's their job is VAR, and they do it, they will get better. Yeah, there will still be anomalies. Mm. There will still be the odd time where it takes 4 minutes or something, and you think, wait a minute, how can you do that? You're a VAR expert. But I think that will become less and less, Gordon. I think that will be a rare thing rather than, I'm not saying it's common now, but yeah. it's not uncommon.
But I don't think our average VAR time, last I checked, was that far off the leagues that have had it forever. So
if you take a bit longer, you make it. Go and get the right decision.
I know, but then that's the bit that kills the in stadium experience.
Yeah,
doesn't it
does. Yeah.
And you said you were at Fir Park watching at the weekend.
But VAR
Andy
does
Halliday.
That anyway. It kills in. Even if it's a 20 second, it's still goal being checked. It still kills in.
That's my point, though. This notion that actually, if we just do this and do that and do that, it'll get immeasurably better. I just don't know if we're just
decisions might become better, but the atmosphere. The in stadium experience and celebrating a goal. Kenny's a striker. Kenny scores a goal. He's coming across the defender. He gets a little flick to his eyes. He's away celebrating, and then he's going to wait. Right, wait a minute, Kenny. What are you doing? You might have been an absolute fraction offside. Yep. You might not have been. 2 minutes later, 3 minutes later. Is it a goal? Is it not a goal? But it kind of deflates everybody. But that's sadly that part's never going to change, Gordon.
Yeah, and I mean the bit that I think will never, and I don't know how you truly get around this. There's obviously a line in there from Motherwell, and the feedback we receive from our own fans and VAR is almost entirely negative. And if given a choice, we believe most would vote to no longer have it in use. It's actually not easy to find anyone who either participates in football or watches it who's happy with the current position. I guess I don't know. I've not taken a scientific poll. Do you think that would be the case? Do you think that would differ in other countries?
Listen, I think people are genuinely kind of sickened with the whole VAR experience, because again, I'll go back to it. Sat on the show the week before it was going to be coming in, and I said, well, it's not going to change anything. It's not going to change the debate. I think there's actually more aggression and more kind of hatred towards VAR based on the fact that you thought it was going to cure everything and everything was going to be, oh, well, no, we'll be able to watch that again. And by the way, they'll see it how I see it, you know, so they'll think that's not a handball. Well, again, ultimately, so much of the decisions are still subjective. The handball, the tackling, is it excessive? Is it no excessive? The only ones that are... The only thing that really is black, if it's a goal, if it's crossed that line, or if it's offside.
Also, kind of the way it dominates the discourse as well. Take this as an example. Here we are on night 129 of the VAR discussion this season, and on one hand, like, and I take it there'll be purists out there who say, well, you shouldn't then. You don't give it that much attention, but how do you not when clubs are putting out statements? You know, that's breaking news. You kind of almost have to react to that. The weekend will come round, so. It's totally dominated the discussion as well. It's shifted the attention away from things.
I think in football in general, there are more discussions on VAR than there was on debatable decisions over a weekend without VAR.
Would we be Wednesday night talking about a Motherwell Aberdeen handball? That means a lot to people like me, but because of the supply and demand nature of football in Glasgow and the West, maybe we wouldn't be. But
I don't think we would be, because I think it would be a genuinely case if it's not VAR and had that not been. See, if that had that not been given, I don't think there's anybody from an Aberdeen perspective would have said, that should have been a penalty. Whereas, and again, the other side, if it had been given, which it wasn't obviously by the referee on field, I don't think there's anybody who would have been saying it is, or like, I don't think that should have been given as a penalty. And I'd had it went either way, nobody would have been talking about that, because it just would have been a good goal for a young player, a young rising star of your game has got another goal.
The bit that, though, I wonder if it's actually realistic, you know, this notion that we could be the leader and it could be some USP of our league that actually we don't have it and we had it and we turned our back on it. I find that hard to imagine. I'm not saying it's right or wrong. I respect anyone who wants rid of it. I find it really hard to imagine that happens.
No, it doesn't, because obviously you've got European competition, and obviously UEFA might well insist that if you want to be part of you know, the top leagues, then you will have to have that. You know, I think more concerning for you is not the offside. The fact is that Lennon Miller, I think, get injured for the 19s, which would be a huge blow if you because he's been, as Kenny said, absolutely outstanding young player, great prospect.
Yeah, I did notice that the 19s played Italy today, lost 3-1. I think Lennon Miller did come off towards the end. I'll tell you what, in terms of hopes for a bright future, Kenny. A midfield duo at under 19 level of Lennon Miller and David Watson looks pretty nice, doesn't it, based on what we see in the Premiership every week. David Watson scored the one in the 3-1 defeat, and a very good goal it was as well. A few other known names in there, like Bobby Wales and Bailey Rice and so on. But I mean, those two are like mainstays in our Premiership at the moment.
Yeah, they are. I mean, they're two. Again, I think there's a really good balance between those two in the midfield as well, with Lennon Miller, the kind of controller, the architect of anything, all kind of get started, and you've got the energy. David Watson, I mean, the goal he scored, actually, I mean, we're saying St Mirren lost X amount of goals in eight. I mean, the goal he scored was absolutely sensational.
Horrendous defending.
It was poor.
Unforgivable, actually.
I think there's a really good balance to that midfield as well.
It's a really good goal today, actually.
And two outstanding players in our game.
All right, thanks to William, another thanks to David for sending this question in. Who are the last seven Dutch players to make over 10 appearances in the Scottish Premiership? Kevin Van Veen, Vicente Bizauen.
I don't know if he's Dutch or not, but it's Jan Dander.
Nope.
Dutch? No.
Sam Lammers.
He's not Jan with a J. That's where you've gone wrong. He's been miles. Sam Lammers, yes.
And Kelrus.
Yes, we'll do more after these.
For football in Glasgow and the West. 0141 951 1025. Clyde One Super Scoreboard.
Jim Duffy, Kenny Miller, both here, both tackling their way through this full-time teaser, and it's topical and it's tough. I like it. Tick some boxes. Against the Netherlands, Scotland play the Netherlands this weekend. Can you name the last seven Dutch players who've made over 10 appearances in the Scottish Premiership? Kevin Van Veen, Sam Lammers, Vicente Bizauen of Aberdeen, and Kelleroos of Aberdeen.
Yeah, I've got nothing.
Dylan Vente.
Yep, of Hibs.
And I'm out.
Okay, the two you've got left, one falls into the, I kind of think you should get this category, because he's a very, very good player. So very well known. Maybe you're struggling to put the Dutch bit there. But a heck of a player who is not, I was going to say not with us, that makes it sound morbid. He's not in the Scottish Premiership anymore, but he's gone on an upwards trajectory. This guy's doing good things in football.
Yeah. You want to give it now?
Go on then.
Frimpong.
Jeremy Frimpong. The last one is, I'll give you a clue to the last one a bit later if you can't get it. Let's bring in Robert in Knightswood. How are you, Robert?
Not bad, my friend, you?
Yeah, not bad, not bad. What are you thinking tonight?
Just talking about Scotland squads. I was obviously seeing the update that came out and stuff, and I'm thinking, why even not kind of try kind of blood some young boys who are doing well coming through? I mean, England have always done it. If you think back to previous tournaments, way back to Walcott and Michael Owen and even Wayne Rooney. Why we not try to kind of give these young boys a shot at the ones who maybe in future years will be the ones playing tournament football for us, you know what I mean? Like, so, I don't know, the boy Doak still injured? Or,
yeah, he's injured.
But obviously when he is fit, even like Sir Lennon Miller, I know he's in the 19 squad, but he's playing 13 football. Even the boy Barron at Aberdeen, I mean, he's going to move on to bigger, better things, I think, next year. Mm-hmm. So why we not kind of blood these boys in and get them about the squad to see what it's all about, 13 football? Yeah.
I get the logic. Are these guys close enough? The guys, so like Doak would have been a brilliant example of this. We'd have been having a right good Ben Doak debate just now if he wasn't injured. Yeah. Sorry, so
particularly, let people know the injuries recently. Exactly. He probably would have got a fair crack at it.
Everybody knows my sentiments on Lennon Miller as an example. But are these boys close enough to be doing this?
Are you just asking for maybe in this squad, Robert, or even thinking about the Euros?
I'm thinking about the Euros, definitely.
So again, you've just named two midfielders, Lennon Miller and Barron, and you might throw Watson into it as well, who's playing well for Kilmarnock when he's Lennon Miller's. But who are you leaving out for that midfield to take Lennon Miller? Or listen, they'll be Scotland caps. There's no doubt Lennon Miller for sure in the future. But if you're thinking about the Euros, and I get it. See, when you named these three guys that England took,
These guys were actually like superstars at the time, you know, and they were bringing something. Ben Doak's the one, because I think, and we've talked about this on the show, I mean, at the start of the season, we talked about this, that could Ben Doak break into it based on he's got something that I think we probably lack in our squad. It is lightning pace. And you think of Rooney, you think of Owen, you think of Walt, that's exactly what they had. But by the way, they were still playing for top, top teams in the Premier League at the time. Lennon Miller will be a Scotland international, I've no doubt about it. But to take one of these guys to the Euros, you're going to have to leave out a Scott McTominay, a Callum McGregor, a John McGinn, a Lewis Ferguson. These guys are, like, I get it, I get the point. This squad, maybe, but not moving forward for the Euros.
Would you not sacrifice, like, say, a Kenny McLean for a like a Conor Barron? Do you know what I mean?
Again, it's, you're asking, would I do it? I probably wouldn't. I get the point as well, because Kenny's a kind of squad player, if you want to call him that, for international. But he's been there over the course and distance with Steve Clark. Steve Clark relies on. By the way, if you watch one of Steve Clark's first subs, is normally always Kenny McLean is on. He's had a massive role in that, obviously, comeback in Norway. But that would be kind of harsh to leave Kenny McLean out of our Euros after playing that kind of role just for a guy, just to blood them.
I like Robert's logic. I get the logic once you boil it down to who are we talking about. Because Conor Barron's is good, and I like Conor Barron as well, but is he chapping on the door of the Scotland team, really?
No, listen, he's not been an absolute regular for a very poor Aberdeen side this year. Lennon Miller, I think, is different. I think Kenny's, you know, obviously a huge fan, and I think everybody that likes football thinks this boy is the next big thing, you know, in Scottish football. I don't think there's any question about that. An outstanding talent. I'm with you, Robert, in the sense that if there is the possibility of taking him along to a tournament somewhere along the line, whether it be this Euros, even if he's not playing, even if he's not part of that 25-man squad or 23, but he could bring him, you know, or is there a possibility of putting him in involved? Because he will be involved within a very, very short period of time. I think even, you know, the first internationals after the Euros, if he's still performing at the same level or it'll be better, then I can see him forcing his way, even though, as Kenny mentioned there, we've got some outstanding talent in the midfield. You know, you've always got to make room for exceptional young talent, and I think he is exceptional. So I agree with you, Lennon Miller, but not just for this year, because
he's not even in the 21s. He's not even in the 21s.
Yeah, but you can't bypass ages. No,
you absolutely can. But by the way, he's deemed not to be good enough to be in the 21s at this moment in time.
I do wonder if that's because the 19s the are playing that elite round.
Maybe it might be due to that. But let's say Lennon Miller will be an international. Mm-hmm. I agree with you. See, if you're, I mean, that's the old hamper boy. You know, we used to have guys used to get taken to tournaments, these young players. What an experience that would mean. I'll go if he wants me to go as a hamper boy. I'll kindly volunteer if he needs any help with that kind of thing.
I think the difficulty now is we don't play. Ironically, we're about to, but it's because of the time of year. We don't really play friendlies anymore. You get the Nations League, and the numbers game is just tough, Robert, isn't it? You look at that squad just now, you look at Callum McGregor, who'll 100% come back in, Aaron Hickey will 100% come back in. It's just hard to make the numbers balance, isn't it, to like take someone for that experience.
I get it. Do you know what I mean? Obviously, Steve Clark's a loyal guy and all that as well, and what's his name? McLean was the first one to keep me my mind. You know what I mean? He did play a big part, especially the game against Norway and all that. But I just think that the best way to bring these players is to give them the experience of it. Do you know what I mean? It's going to pay dividends in the future for maybe not for this tournament, but for the next one, hopefully the one after that. Do you know what I mean?
And by the way, Robert, it will happen. You know, there's no doubt. There's always a time in an international team that there's that transition player that's kind of coming towards the end, and you have to blood these young players, particularly the elite ones. And at this moment, again, the ones that we've talked about, there's no doubt. Like Lennon's probably the furthest ahead, and the guys that we're looking at who will be the next one. Probably you're looking to blood into maybe a Nations League game or the next friendly international.
God will tell you. I mean, he mentioned the other one. Obviously, I love watching Scotland, but well before Billy Gilmour was involved, he was still in the Chelsea. And I kept saying, "How's he on the team?" You know, in the Scotland squad, because I felt he was so good, even though he was only in the fringes of the Chelsea first team at that time. And eventually, he got himself in, and eventually established himself as an important part. Yeah, sometimes you just need a door to open for you, and just that wee opportunity.
I've mentioned the word COVID on the show for a while. Yeah, it sort of sent shivers down the spine. But that caused the squad sizes to be increased, and Turnbull and Gilmour and Patterson got added to the squad. So, you just wonder if that would have happened. It would have happened eventually, for sure.
I mean, good players will eventually force their way through it. And whether it's Conor Barn, David Watson, Lennon Miller, or anybody else, you know, that might be on the horizon, you know, football evolves and there'll be a natural evolution. Some players will gradually be phased out and these young boys will be pushed in.
And it's about levels. You know, you're talking exactly. Billy Gummers, when he played for Chelsea, even in the odd game that he got, he was man of the match.
In the bench in the Champions League final. Yeah.
And then you've got, and I think Ben Doak does fall into that category. Yeah. I mean, if you're getting in Liverpool squads, you might be worth considering.
We're fast running out of time. Do you want the final say on anything, Robert?
Well, your boy earlier was plugging a wee thing he's doing. I'm actually a stand-up comic. I'm doing a show for the Glasgow Comedy Festival just now. I'm doing it tomorrow night in Tennant's Bar at 6:30. Rob Kane. It's called Near Misses. So any free tickets to any Superscoreboard pundits, apart from obviously Hugh Keevan, so you're going to get my humour, but.
Super. Rob, well, we wish you all the best with it. Take care.
All
the best, there you are. Rob Kane. We'll put it in the live stream. Rob Kane near Mrs. Tennant's Bar. Right, you've got one to get. Dutch player in the last 7 Dutch players to make over 10 appearances in the Scottish Premiership.
What team did he play for? You need to give us some sort of clue.
I think the biggest clue by a mile is that it is an extremely well known Dutch footballing name and family. He hasn't hit
There's
these
no
heights.
Cruyff's playing.
He hasn't hit these heights, to be fair. Played for Motherwell. Got it.
Got it.
Man, go for
you
it.
Remember him?
I've got actually got his dad's shirt. Or is it his
there you go. No, it's not his dad. No, his dad. Is that a cousin or something?
No, is that cousin? Is that? He's Seedorf.
Sherwin.
What's his
daughter's
first name?
Sherwin.
Yeah,
Sherwin Seedorf.
Sherwin
Seedorf scored a great goal at Tynecastle, and Seedorf, I can't remember.
No, I didn't want that.
Thank you, Kenny Miller and Jim Duffy. Thanks for all your calls, your tweets and your company. We will be back tomorrow with Gordon DL, if he's back from that birthday weekend that he had in St Andrews. Mark Wilson should be here as well, and Callum is up next.